to y'all come up and tell a little bit about what's going on in North Carolina. And if any of you have been to the back and seen a whole bunch of bags of instant oatmeal, that's part of the story. Thank
you. Okay, I've been telling y'all about my long-time friend from college. She lives near Chimney Rock. This is the friend Lee Raymer and her family. Their farm name is Thermal Ridge. And this is where your supplies went to in North Carolina.
Hi. just to give you a brief background of us, in June, this is kind of, to me, just God's way. In June, I decided to get a produce stand, which my husband laughed at me about because I was trying to teach my little boy about word problems. It went from us creating the produce to us going and to Asheville Farmers Market and buying. We were going through 5 bushels of tomatoes a weekend and over 15 dozen eggs. And so when Hurricane Helene came, I went and got muscadine grapes to make jelly. That's all this was going to be. Yes, and we got pumpkins and we were ready to go. As soon as the storm happened, we went to put this stuff out to sell. We didn't have much damage. We did have water come up. Our neighbors did have water go into their home. But we didn't know. We didn't have electric. We didn't have anything. And you had to go into town to the courthouse to get anything. And so about the second or third day, I was out there trying to sell produce, and I had a farmer come up to me, and he goes, "This tomato would be real good if I had bread." And I said, "Sir, you don't have bread." He said, "No." And I was like, "Uh-oh, we got a problem." So I ran to the house. I got him half a loaf of bread, and my husband came home, and I said, "We need to do something." So I said, for a farmer, to me, in my eyes, a farmer to come up and ask for help for bread, that was something big. So we started getting in touch with friends from Charlotte. They started bringing us in supplies. And then as we were able to see what was going on around us, it was devastating. We live 10 minutes from Chimney Rock. That's one of our favorite places to go. Towns, we have people living in lean-tos and shelters. If you need to see God, you come to the end of our driveway. I have stood at the end of the driveway and said, "Lord, what are we gonna do? I don't know if I have enough supplies," and I'll have 3 trucks show up. It has been an amazing experience. I've been in mounds of stuff and being like, "Lord, where is the size 4 diaper?" And miraculously, it's right there. But even more so is I've got to thank y'all, because if I didn't have the community support and churches like y'all helping us, we've gotten a container in from a church in Virginia, and we've gotten so much stuff from churches, and your buckets, your quilts, they made a huge difference, and we just really appreciate you. So thank you so much.
Before we have our prelude, I'll just make one last announcement. We have a problem this morning, and it is a wonderful problem to have. We actually printed 100 bulletins, and we went out. So if you look and you see a neighbor who doesn't have a bulletin nearby them, and you've got 2 or 3, if you could share those, that would be wonderful. So let us prepare our hearts for worship with our prayer.
Thank you.
confession and forgiveness. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit,
that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take a moment for reflection and prayer. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin
and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
By the mercy of God, we are united with Jesus Christ, and in him we are forgiven. We rest now in his peace, and we rise every morning to serve him. Amen. Let us sing, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
Pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Good and steadfast God, in your Son we've been given the gift of eternal life and righteousness before you. Empower us to bring the knowledge of your Son to a world hungering and thirsting for mercy and righteousness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Share the peace with one another. Thank you.
Please be seated. We are honored to have our sanctuary choir here at this time.
On this All Saints Sunday, that we all will be called home by our Lord and Savior. Please stand for the reading of God's Word.
The first reading is from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 31, verses 6 through 8, and it can be found on page 204 in your pew Bible. Be strong and courageous. Do not fear or be in dread of them, for it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Then Moses summoned Joshua and said to him in the sight of all Israel, be strong and courageous, for you shall go with this people into the land that the Lord has sworn to their fathers to give them, and you shall put them in possession of it. It is the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed. Here ends the reading. The second reading is from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6b through 8a, and chapter 4, verses 3 through 5, and it can be found on page 1181 in your pew Bible. For this reason, I remind you to fan into the flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, and fulfill your ministry. Here ends the reading.
Please be seated. Children, please come forward.
Let me see if I can get this on here. Sorry, I'm getting wired up. Kind of tricky with a... All right, well, let's talk about All Saints. It's those people that have gone before us, that lived here, believed in Jesus, and have gone on to heaven. Now, on Thursday, some of you may have had the opportunity to trick-or-treat. Yeah. How many of you are scared of something?
A monster.
A monster, you're scared of monsters?
I'm scared of
a snake. That's a good one. I'm scared of snake. Wait, one at a time. One at a time. I want to hear you.
I got a coyote in my backyard.
Oh, my. Oh, my. A coyote in Laura's backyard. So we'll be careful. Spiders? Luna?
A bat, because we saw a bat on our
Okay, a bat.
Bonsky.
Just a minute. David? What are you scared of?
Me.
Snake clouds? Okay. A tornado. Different kinds of weather make us scared. Chicken snakes. Any kind of snake makes me scared. How about you? Just a minute, Laura. Yeah, snakes are pretty, can be pretty scary. But God put them here on earth for a reason, didn't he? Well, you know, there's one thing that I know is true, and the saints that have gone on before us, that no matter what, we don't have to be scared of anything, Laura. We don't have to be scared of snakes or spiders or coyotes. We don't have to. Or Mike Wazowski. Whoever you said, you're exactly right. We don't have to be scared of them. One thing's never going to change, and that is who? Who is not going to change?
God.
God. And his son, who?
Jesus.
Jesus, that's exactly right. Yes, Laurel, I'm listening. Well, you know what? We're going to talk about how to take care of what you're afraid of. You don't have to be afraid of anything. Yes, Jace.
I'm scared of fish.
You're scared of a fish? You are? Oh, my.
I know what type of fish. Socks? No, that's...
You know what? We could sit here all day, but you know what? Pastor Dave has a really good message about fear that he wants to share with you. Correct, Pastor Dave? You want to have a moment to speak. I thought so. Well, there's a verse, Deuteronomy 31:8. The Lord himself, listen, I'll talk to you. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you or forsake you. Do not be afraid and do not be discouraged. So you see, the promise from God is that we're never alone. Who is always with us?
God.
And he sent who?
Jesus.
He sent Jesus. So I'm going to give you your own little private Jesus that you can keep with you in your pocket or on your dresser. Now, do we have to have a little plastic Jesus to know that he's there?
I got a dresser.
We don't, do we? We don't. He is everywhere all the time. And he has promised, just a minute. All right, eyes on me. Eyes on me. I don't want you to miss this. This is important. That no matter what, God's promise is you're never alone. And do not be afraid. So, when you get ready to go, I'm going to give you what?
God, Jesus.
Jesus. And you know what? All of the saints that went on before us. And just like that song that you sang when the saints go marching in, do you think they're afraid anymore?
No.
They're not afraid anymore. Let's say a prayer.
Dear Lord,
thank you for staying with us.
Thank you for staying with us.
You promise you will never leave us.
You promise you will never leave us.
And that you will take care of us.
And that you will take care of us.
No matter what happens.
No matter what happens.
Thank you for the truth.
Thank you for the truth.
Your Bible.
Your Bible.
And your promises we love.
And your promises we love.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Remember not to be afraid.
Amen.
All right. Take your Jesus and don't forget your bulletin.
Not almond.
Not almond.
Once again. Jake has his Bible bed. All right. We love you, Mother. Everyone.
Take what you get.
Come on,
buddy. You got one? Okay.
Go on down.
There we go.
Pink, 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 pink. Oh,
that's
yellow. I want pink.
All right, going back to the seat.
Two?
Nope, you only need one.
That's fine.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Leslie. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Gospel from the 12th chapter of John.
Glory to you, Lord.
The next day, the news that Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem swept through the city. A large crowd of Passover visitors took palm branches and went down to the road to meet him. They shouted, "Praise God! Blessing on the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hail to the King of Israel!" Jesus found a young donkey and rode on it, fulfilling the prophecy that said, "Don't be afraid, people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming, riding on a donkey's colt." His disciples didn't understand at the time that this was the fulfillment of prophecy. But after Jesus entered into his glory, they remembered what had happened and realized that these things had been written about him. Many in the crowd had seen Jesus call Lazarus from the tomb, raising him from the dead, and they were telling others about it. That was the reason so many went out to meet him, because they had heard about his miraculous sign. Then the Pharisees said to each other, "There's nothing we can do. Look, everyone has gone after him." Many people did believe in him, however, including some of the Jewish leaders, but they wouldn't admit it for fear that the Pharisees would expel them from the synagogue, for they loved human praise more than the praise of God. Jesus shouted to the crowds, "If you trust me, you are trusting not only me, but also God who sent me. For when you see me, you are seeing the one who sent me. I have come as light to shine in this dark world, so that all who put their trust in me will no longer remain in the dark." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Well, if you haven't figured out, this isn't your typical All Saints Sunday message. It deals with fear, and so many have that fear of the unknown after this life, or the fear of death, and that's why I thought we would focus on that this morning. Just a brief history on myself. I actually went to my youth pastor when I was a teenager because I thought something was wrong with me because I wasn't afraid of death. I mean, I didn't hate this life, but I wasn't afraid because I knew that leaving this life meant to be present with Jesus in heaven. But most of the time, most of what I heard was, "Oh, weeping and crying, and you've got to be so afraid." What's to be afraid of? We're going to glory if we know Jesus as Lord and Savior. And so my youth pastor assured me that there was nothing wrong with me, that I was just fine having that outlook on life. Well, as some of you know, I was a chef before I became a pastor. But what you may not know is I was considered a turnaround specialist. Many hotels and restaurants sought me out and hired me to take their failing kitchens and either restore them to prestige or to profit. I was recruited from Michigan down to the Orlando area of Florida by a company that contracted food and beverage services for more than a dozen embassy suite hotels. I worked in four Embassy Suite hotels in Florida in less than a year. I would go in one, I would clean house, both literally and figuratively. I would get one property up and going strong, only to be relocated to another failing one. After a while, this would wear on me. I would just get a place to the point where I didn't have to work 12 to 16 hours a day, 6 or 7 days a week, and I could start to enjoy the place, and poof, I was gone. I eventually got tired of it in a little restaurant on Amelia Island, recruited me, and I went to work in this cute little resort town to return that restaurant to its glory to be the top restaurant on the island, and we got to number 2 in less than a year, and that was the end of that story. The restaurant was again profitable, it was doing well, but I would eventually lose my job as the executive chef because the manager felt threatened by all of this success. Side note, her qualifications for running the place had very little to do with her managerial or maitre d' skills and had to do a whole lot more with, shall we say, fooling around with the boss. My second to last job in a hotel was for a DoubleTree, where I spent 6 months doing those 12 to 16 hours, 6 to 7 days a week, to get things better. Things got better where I could actually step back and only work 6 days, maybe 10 to 12 each day. But the hotel manager was called down here to Atlanta to run an Atlanta Doubletree for the Olympics. She wanted me to go with her, but Dana, she wasn't too keen on moving again. I don't know why. Maybe it had to do something with the fact that we moved 7 times in our first 2 years of marriage. So I stayed, and the new managers, who didn't know how bad things had been or where the hotel had come from, they only saw what needed to be improved and thought that I wasn't putting in enough hours, 10 to 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, not enough. I looked at both of them in a meeting, one divorced, hadn't seen his kids in years, the other going through a messy divorce, and I thought, is this where I'm going to be in a few years if I keep this up? So I told them right then and there on the spot that they had 2 weeks to fill my position, for I would be gone. You should have seen the look of surprise and fear on their faces, because they knew I didn't have anything lined up. But by the end of the day, God came through, and I had something else. I stayed and did my 2 weeks, as I promised I would. Yes, I do have many success stories and even some lasting friendships that came out of that time in my life. But on all sides of the situation, I dealt with people who would act irrationally due to fear. Fear of the unknown, fear of high or changing expectations, fear of losing their power, or simply the fear of being alone or passed over. So this morning's big idea is that all of us have fears, but God is calling us to be unafraid. So how do we do that? Well, here's 3 quick thoughts for me to share with you this morning on being unafraid. And the first thought is change and the unknown can cause fear. So be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and do not panic before them. For the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. Then Moses called for Joshua, and all of Israel watched, and he said to them, be strong and courageous, for you will lead these people into the land that the Lord swore to their ancestors that he would give them. What was going on this morning in that passage that we read from Deuteronomy? Well, Moses was in the home stretch. He had served his time. He was being transitioned out. A new leader would be in charge, and his name was Aaron. And as we read the end of Deuteronomy and the beginning of Joshua, we see that God's work hadn't stopped. It hadn't slowed down. And as I read these 2 books, it actually seems like God ramps up the agenda. Things get real. Moses and God are preparing the people for not just their new leader, but their next great journey. They had been wandering from about 40 years, and they were finally going to the promised land. But then the people started to freak out. They're scared. There's rumors of giants in the land, fear of the unknown, fear of change. In this, it wasn't Aaron that they weren't showing faith in. It was God. And he is the one in charge, not the leader du jour. When I read this, or when I read this, I think of what God has been doing this year. We have had and will have some very big challenges, not just here at Bible. But if you haven't heard, this is a presidential election year, just in case you didn't hear anything about that. I know it's a really good secret. I hear so many Christians expressing dire predictions if this one wins or if the other one wins. Why are we so freaked out over something so relatively small as an election? Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying they don't matter. And I'm definitely not saying don't be uninformed or uninvolved. On Tuesday, go out and vote your biblical conscience. If you have voted already, great. But y'all know I came from Chicagoland. I spent the last 18 years. So as they say there, vote early and vote often. Yeah. But friends, think about it. In the grand scheme of things, what is most important is putting our trust in God, not in men. God is in control even in the midst of the earthly chaos and change. No matter who's in charge, our calling is the same, isn't it? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. If we focus on that half as much as we focus on the chaos of this world would be such a better place. The second thought this morning is that we fear what we don't understand. Don't be afraid, people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming riding on a donkey's colt. His disciples didn't understand at the time that this was the fulfillment of prophecy. But after Jesus entered into his glory, they remembered what had happened and realized that these things had been written about him. Now, this reading is often used on Palm Sunday, but Palm Sunday is kind of a strange day when you think about it. I mean, we're nearing the end of the season of Lent, a time of reflection, a time of giving up, just a few days till the darkest day on the church calendar, and all of a sudden, we're singing praises and we're having a parade. Talk about a swing of emotions. Now, the disciples, they weren't dealing with it like we do. They were all about the party. They thought that they had finally arrived with the reception that Jesus is getting. Continue on, many people did believe in him, however, including some of the Jewish leaders, but they wouldn't admit it for the fear that the Pharisees would expel them from the synagogue, for they loved human praise more than the praise of God. For some, particularly many of the religious people, they just didn't understand. That, coupled with a threat of losing their power, made them do some really dumb things out of fear. What dumb things have you done out of fear? I know I've got my share. I think we could all think of a few examples in our lives. Do you all remember the empty shelves and the lack of toilet paper and the price gouging during the pandemic of 2020? Now, the biggest issue we found out wasn't the virus itself, but it was the fear of the unknown. How many remember when the world was going to end because of Y2K? Anybody remember that one? How many hurricanes or tropical storms have been forecasted to wipe us out over the years? Yes, I know, just a few months ago, we had a tropical storm park over Tybee and dump rain on us for about a week, and we had some flooding, and, you know, there were some issues, but southeastern Georgia didn't disappear, did it? Then, I'm sure you remember, in September, right, a little thing called Helene that we're still dealing with. A lot of us lost our electricity, but, oh, it was so much worse in so many other places, crops and buildings and the like. But the common folk of Bible Lutheran Church, the common folk of Effingham County and many other places stepped up, sprung into action, and cleared the roads so the crews could get in. They served their neighbors and their friends, and it worked out. Yes, there is a long road to recovery for many, but God's people are doing what God's people do. Amen? Providing a helping hand. You see, most of us aren't virologists. We're not computer experts or even meteorologists. So while we experience these things every day, we usually don't fully understand them, and thus we are susceptible to fear. With all that's been going on in the last several years, I'm constantly asking myself, is this what Paul is warning us about in his second letter to Timothy? For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desire and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject the truth and chase after myths. But you should keep a clear mind in every situation. Don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Work at telling others the good news and fully carry out the ministry that God has called you to do. Well, back to the religious leaders of Jesus' time for just a moment. They disregarded, bent, and even broke their own rules and their laws just to get Jesus because they feared what he was capable of doing. They feared losing their power, losing their control over the people. They just didn't listen to him, to what he was saying. He wasn't here to start an earthly revolution. He was here to set us free. But in their fear, they were blinded, and it made it impossible for them to understand what Jesus was saying. Now, when I get to have gospel conversations with someone who tells me they don't like organized religion, and that usually comes about, 10 seconds after they find out what it is I do for a living. But when I do get to have those conversations, I tell them that Jesus had a problem with the religious people too. As a matter of fact, they're the ones who had him murdered. You see, it seems that a lot of people who claim to dislike religion and thus Jesus actually find out that they like Jesus when they hear what he has to say. It's just that so many in our world are afraid because they don't know the real Jesus. They only know what they see or hear on the TV or the internet. I often wonder, am I helping them see the real Jesus by the way that I'm living? Or am I enforcing the wrong impression that they have of him? And finally, this morning, third, if we turn to the light, we will lose our fear. A few chapters earlier in Paul's second letter to Timothy, he says this, "Fan into flames the spiritual gift God gave you when I laid hands on you. For God himself has not given us a spirit of fear or timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline." Friend, what's your fear? Is it snakes, gators, a certain individual or political party winning in an election, change? How about a bad year for the dogs? I can say without hesitation that the majority of you sitting here this morning probably have a fear of rejection. I know I do. Is that why we are so often afraid to have conversations with our friends, our family, co-workers, or neighbors about what Jesus is doing in and through us? Paul finishes that thought in 2 Timothy 1. "For God has not given us the spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. So never be ashamed to tell others about our Lord." How many people do you know could use encouragement, forgiveness, or a release from fear? They need to hear about the real Jesus, the one that loves them, forgives them, and died for them. Here's a radical thought. Invite them to join us here next week or share our live stream with them. The worst they can do is say no or simply not respond. Need some help? Ask God to give you the words. Read a gospel or an epistle. Don't just skim over it. Really read it. Dig into it. Meditate on it. Ask God to help you burn it into your mind, your body, and your soul. Why? The words we carry in our minds are available to transform any moment. When there's a verse that speaks to you, take it, write it down on a card, put it on a mirror in your bathroom or on your cell phone, a calendar, put it on your social or post it in your car. If you're an auditory learner, listen to scripture being read on your computer or one of those apps on your phone. If you're a visual learner, light a candle and recite these words, "God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all." Meditate on it. Focus on them and on him. Do it over and over for just a few minutes a day. Don't just read it or listen to it. Memorize it. Meditate on God's word and then do something with it. Turn to the light, Jesus, and lose your fear. Amen. Amen. Well, if you're able, I encourage you to stand and we will sing, "Oh Jesus, I Have Promised." Let us join together in proclaiming our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Jesus Christ and for all people according to their needs. All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father. We too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in death, like a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servants who have gone before us. We name them now quietly in our hearts. We humbly beseech you, sheep of your own fold, lambs of your own flock, sinners of your own redeeming, receive them into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we give you glory. Raise up your church. Re-engage people. Bring us back to fellowship, where we can feel love and extend that love and that acceptance, Lord. Father, help people to have the courage to speak to and bring their friends. We celebrate you and all that you are doing in our lives, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, please bring your peace to Carolyn Boyd as her son has now been called home. Father, we lift you, Ernie and Ron. We thank you for the healing of Judy Brown, Joanne, and Marilyn Sellinger, Lord. We pray for continued recovery for Pastor Rob, Chap Bennett, Suzanne Steinhardt, Jeff Ambrose, Pam Royals, Kathy Gardner, Leon Ledford, and Robert Rollins. We continue to lift to you, Lord, Virginia, Brenda, and Daniel, Miss Dot. Give them the healing, give them the resources that you know that is best for each and every one. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We lift you, our ministry partners here in Effingham County and throughout all the LCMC, Lord, in our community and around the world. We lift you, the 80-plus churches, Lord, of the LCMC that need pastors to lead them this very morning. And Father, we ask you'd be with the struggles in our government. People have lost trust in the government, law enforcement, and the justice system. We beg you to restore honor and fairness. Please help us as our country continues to distort the meaning of family, sexuality, and marriage. Father, rescue us from the increasingly grave effects that befall us, our children, and our society when we stray from your guidance. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray our offering prayer. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts. With them we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let Let us sing, "Let the Vineyards." Salutary that we should at all times and all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, through Christ our Lord. In the blessedness of your saints, you have given us a glorious promise of the hope of our calling, that moved by their witness and supported by their fellowship, we may run with perseverance the race that is set before us, and with them receive the unfolding crown of glory. And so, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we sing praise to your name, and we join their unending hymn. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord, our Savior, Jesus, he took the bread and he blessed it, and then he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup and he blessed it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and drink. This is the new covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this in remembrance of me." So we drink this cup. We eat this bread, remembering his sacrifice some 2,000 years ago, but clinging to his promise of his presence and his forgiveness. Let's pray the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please come at the direction of the ushers. We have grape juice if you prefer that to the wine. Simply let your server know. Let us sing "On You Day."
See you.
Please stand for our hymn. May the body and blood of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and keep you in the days to come. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray our prayer. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this healing power of the gift of life. And we pray that in your mercy you would strengthen us through this gift in faith towards you and in fervent love towards one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the God of peace fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Let us sing our sending song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. The Lord.
Thanks be to God.